This is the motto of the show, Hour of the Truth. Rome never changes. They used to call us heretics and send the Inquisition to kill us. Today they call us terrorists and send on their crusades. Times and methods may have changed, but the goal still stays the same. Extirpate the remnant of the true Word of God, Bible-believing people who uphold the truth in Jesus Christ's name.
From 1203 to 1805, 50 million Christians died. Suffering at the hands of Rome, cause they believed in Christ alone. They died through Europe, especially Spain, for they saw all but Christ in vain. He suffered by his death for men, to save them from their awful sin. 600 years of martyred saints that history cannot erase. With iron heel and iron hand, the Roman popes rule the land. Those ignorant of history may be swept into apostasy. We won't be loved by Rome, sweet lie, with 50 million reasons why. Salvation is by faith alone, in Christ alone, by grace alone. A sovereign God gives faith to man. Salvation's in the Maker's hand. This gospel offends Rome today. They offer up another way, a counterfeit, a compromise. Beware the ancient papal lie, with such a cloud of witnesses who by grace died in their Lord. Recall their memory to say, by the same faith we live today.
Hello everybody, this is Jörg Lissler once again, and I welcome you to another broadcast and a show on Hour of the Truth. Today we have the 3rd of September, 2015, some 20 days to go until the Antichrist, the biblical, historical, and prophetic Antichrist of the Bible, will come to the country that was founded on Protestant thought by Protestants who fled Europe to escape the rule of the Antichrist in the time and founding a new nation, a new world called the United States of America today. Just 20 days to go, and in that light I think it is very interesting to first and for all read to you a little article that can be found on a website called the Catholic News Agency. I'm surely not a Catholic, but you have to know your enemy, and you have to know what your enemy says to understand him. And this is a very interesting article. I think you all will agree with me. The article is called All Priests Will Be Able to Forgive Sin of Abortion During Jubilee for Mercy. Speaking, of course, of the coming Jubilee year. Now, the Vatican, Vatican City published this on September 1st, 2015. In a new set of pastoral guidelines for the upcoming Holy Year of Mercy, Pope Francis has made some significant moves, allowing all priests to forgive the sin of abortion and granting SSPX priests the faculty to forgive sins. Now, in other words, which I might inject right here, this says that the Pope makes murder legal, and that the Pope says you can even break another of the laws and commandments given by the God of the Bible to Moses on Mount Sinai in that time, thou shalt not kill, because an abortion is nothing else than murder. And now the priests are even allowed to forgive the sin of murder. But continue reading, and you make up your own mind what you think of this. I'm just reading here. Quote, "One of the serious problems of our time is clearly the changed relationship with respect to life," unquote, the Pope said in a September 1st letter addressed to Archbishop Rino Fisichella, president of the Pontifical Council for the New Evangelization, charged with organizing the Jubilee. In today's society, quote, "a widespread and insensitive mentality," unquote, has become an obstacle to welcoming new life, with many who don't fully understand the deep harm done by, quote-unquote, the tragedy of abortion, he said. However, Francis also noted that there are many women who, despite thinking abortion is wrong, feel that they have no other choice. Well, who gives them that feeling that they don't have any other choice, or who lets those people live in a world where they think they don't have any other choice? That's the Pope. You're right. The Antichrist doesn't give them any other choice to think that way. If these people knew their Bible, they knew that they would have another choice. Continue. Quote, "I am well aware of the pressure that has led them to this decision. I know that this is an existential and moral ordeal. I have met so many women who bear in their heart the scar of this agonizing and painful decision," unquote, he said. "A woman who obtains an abortion automatically incurs a latae sententiae, excommunication, along with those who assisted her in the process. Because of this excommunication, the sin of abortion can normally only be absolved by a bishop or certain priests appointed by him. For specific occasions, such as Advent or Lent, some bishops extend this faculty to all priests within their diocese. In the U.S., the faculty to absolve abortion has already been delegated to all priests." However, Pope Francis is talking, Pope Francis is taking it to a universal level. Well, Roman Catholic, meaning universal. He said that the forgiveness of God can't be denied to a person who has sincerely repented, especially when the person comes to the sacrament of confession in order to be genuinely reconciled with the Father. Because of this, Francis said, he has allowed all priests for the Jubilee of Mercy, quote, "to absolve of sin of abortion those who have procured it and who, with contrite heart, seek forgiveness for it," unquote. In another significant move, Francis has also allowed priests from the Society of St. Pius X to, quote, "validly and licitly," unquote, hear confessions during the Holy Year. And there you can see that the Inquisition is going into another gear, because the confession box is always, or has always been, the source for intelligence of the Roman Catholic Church, and also during the Inquisition. "This Jubilee Year of Mercy excludes no one," the Pope said in his letter, explaining several bishops have informed him of the Society's, quote, "good faith and sacramental practice," unquote, albeit combined with an, quote unquote, "uneasy situation from the pastoral standpoint." The Society of St. Pius X was founded by Archbishop Marcel Lefebvre in 1970 to form priests as a response to what he described as errors that had crept into the Church following the Second Vatican Council. Its relations with the Holy See became strained in 1988 when Archbishop Lefebvre consecrated four bishops without the permission of Pope John Paul II. The illicit consecration resulted in the excommunication of the five bishops. The excommunications were lifted in 2009 by Benedict XVI, and since then, negotiations between the Society and the Vatican to re-establish full communion have continued. In this letter, Francis expressed his confidence that solutions to recovering full communion with the priests and superiors of the Society could be found in the near future. In the meantime, quote, "motivated by the need to respond to the good of these faithful through my own disposition," unquote, he declared that those who approach priests of the Society for confession during the Jubilee, quote, "shall validly and licitly receive the absolution for their, of their sins," unquote. Pope Francis also turned to those who, due to reasons of age, illness, or incarceration, will not be able to walk through the holy door in order to obtain the plenary indulgence connected with the Jubilee. Each of the four major basilicas in Rome has a holy door, which are normally sealed shut from the inside so that they cannot be opened. The doors are only opened during Jubilee years so that pilgrims can enter them through them in order to gain the indulgence. In May, it was announced that as part of the Holy Year for Mercy, holy doors will for the first time be designated in dioceses and will be located either in the cathedral or in a church of special significance or a shrine of particular importance for pilgrimages. For the elderly and sick, often confined to their homes, the Pope said that living their illness and suffering with joyful hope and attending Mass, receiving communion and participating in community prayer, quote, even through the various means of communication, unquote, is a way that they can receive the Jubilee indulgence. In regards to prisoners, Francis said that they will be able to obtain the indulgence in the chapels of the prisons. He said that directing their thoughts and prayers to God each time they cross the door of their cell would signify their passage through the holy door. Quote, because the mercy of God is able to transform hearts and is also able to transform bars into an experience of freedom, unquote. This is just incredible what this guy says. I can't believe these people who believe this man. The Pope also pointed to how a Jubilee indulgence can be obtained for the deceased and encouraged faithful to pray to the saints for them during Mass that, quote, the merciful face of the Father, unquote, free them of the remainder of every fault. Francis then turned to the corporal and spiritual works of mercy, explaining that the experience of mercy, quote, becomes visible in the witness of concrete signs as Jesus himself taught us, unquote. Therefore, each time that someone personally performs one or more of the 13 works of mercy, interesting number, such as feeding the hungry, visiting the sick, burying the dead, willingly forgiving offenses, comforting the afflicted, or praying for the living and dead, that person will, quote, surely obtain the Jubilee indulgence, unquote. Praying for the dead. Where do you find that in the Bible? The Bible calls that necromancing. And it is an abomination to God. But yeah, you know how he twists the truth. Continue reading, also I'm getting very sick here. For all those who will celebrate and experience the grace of the Jubilee, either as pilgrims in Rome or in the individual dioceses, Francis prayed that the indulgence would be a, quote, genuine experience of God's mercy, unquote, for each one. He affirmed that in order to receive the indulgence, one must make a pilgrimage to the Holy Door, either in Rome or in the diocese, quote, as a sign of the deep desire for true conversion, unquote. In addition to the cathedrals and shrines where the Holy Door of Mercy will be opened, the Pope also designated that the indulgence could be obtained in the churches traditionally identified as Jubilee churches. He stressed the importance of remembering that the reception of the indulgence must be linked, quote, first and foremost to the sacrament of reconciliation and to the celebration of the Holy Eucharist with a reflection on mercy, unquote. It will be necessary, he said, quote, to accompany these celebrations with the profession of faith and with prayer for me and for the intentions that I bear in my heart for the good of the Church and of the entire world, unquote. This ends the reading of this little text, and I cannot wait, even though I know he probably hasn't prepared for that, to hear a little comment from Walt Stickle, my co-host on the show today on Hour of the Truth to that. So I leave it over to you, and I beg everyone to go and read this article. I will, of course, include the link in the video that I will make on make later on from the show, that you can read it for yourself. What blasphemy that I just read here to you, and this man, I don't know, sorry, I can't get it anymore. Walt, please take over, I'm feeling sick here. How are you doing there?
Well, I get the same feeling when I watch these newscasts where the Pope is speaking and the people in the crowds that are swooning are like when the Pope came here in 2008 and filled Yankee Stadium. You see the, you understand then, but as children of God, you know, he tells us that the world will wonder after the beast. And that's what we're actually seeing right to this day. And, you know, something I think we all, I had a friend of mine the other day, I said, you know, I'm a little kind of, sometimes this kind of depresses me. I said, you know, I have so much evidence, and the more that the Vatican Jesuit Global Conspiracy and the pieces of the conspiracy puzzle that I put together in this little booklet, when I print a book on my printer, I just got a little inexpensive cutter, so I have to split it up in six times. I count out five pages at a time. And it's, you know, some of the statements, you know, that after you have so much evidence, and to think that the Pope is going to speak here in a couple of weeks. You know, but I think we've got to go back. One of the books that really shook me to the ground was when Tom Fress read Romanism and the Reformation by Henry Grattan Guinness. Well, I've read this before on the broadcast, but this can't be said enough. Because it's kind of heavy, and it kind of makes you a little weary. And the people that come up on this broadcast and listen to this call, most of them are researchers themselves. But this was the last paragraph in Henry Grattan Guinness's book, Romanism and the Reformation. He delivers the gospel in his last paragraph. And if you, this is right up on my website, granddesignexposed.com. I have it right on the front page. But I did a Bible study one day, and there's over 25 Bible verses that Henry Grattan Guinness uses in this presentation of delivering the gospel. Here's Henry Grattan Guinness quote. Remember that there is only one mediator between God and man, that there is but one sacrifice for sins, offered once for all and forever. Through the one mediator, by the one sacrifice, draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you. You need no mediator, which means no pope, between yourself and Christ. The priest is a false intruder there. Jesus calls you to come to himself. He is both human and divine. He is bone of your bone and flesh of your flesh, yet without sin. God is in him. He is one with us and one with God. Suffer nothing to come between your soul and him. Suffer no saint, no angel, no virgin, no priest to come between you and Jesus Christ. Go to him for the pardon of all your sins. Make to him your confessions. He can absolve you and will, yea, does, if you truly believe in him. Priestly absolution is a lie. It is a blasphemous pretense. The sentence, I absolve thee, whether from the mouth of a Roman priest or a Protestant minister, is profane. Be not deluded by it. Your fellow sinner cannot absolve you from the sins you have committed against God. Turn from these idols and vanities. Jesus is all you need. His blood is sufficient to atone and cleanse those who simply trust in him from all sin. Search the scriptures. They testify him. They testify of him. Come to him that you may have life. His heart is touched with the feeling of your infirmities. None can sympathize as he can. None can help as he. To you, to each one, he says, him that cometh unto me, I will in no wise cast out. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall not pass away. Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life. Thou alone art all we need, for thou alone art all in all. End of quote. That is this gospel delivered by Henry Grattan Guinness.
Yeah, and what you just read is an absolute contradiction to all the stuff that I just read before.
that's right. Isn't that something? I thought of the same thing when I was reading that. You know,
absolutely.
And something that's on the last broadcast, I mentioned the age of irrationalism. And irrationalism is, the meaning is irrational thought, expression, or behavior. Belief and feeling, instinct, are non-rational forces rather than reason. that's been mulling around in this book that I put together. I realized that the book salesman, and I call him book salesman, and you say, well, what do you mean, book salesman? Let me define a book salesman. A book salesman has an agenda. He writes a book, and he caters to a certain audience. He tries to cater to a broad audience so he can sell more books. Now, I'll give you an example of a book salesman, Tex Mars. He writes numerous books, but he leaves out history. And another thing that came to my mind this last week is everybody has heard of the word science fiction. Some people like to read science fiction. Well, that's always kind of been a touchy subject for me because I've seen how bizarre some of these books are. But what they mean by science fiction, they're taking science and making fiction out of science. That's what a science fiction book is. Now, the book salesman and people that write on prophecy is a million-dollar business. When one thing, in the article that we're going to read today, how America became a Jesuit enclave, is you can never see how the Jesuits became an enclave in this country unless you have history. See, and what they have given us is history fiction. They're making fiction out of history. It's that simple. I'll give you another good example. Is Ralph Everson. Not everybody's probably heard of Ralph Everson, but he's been around. He was on Bill Cooper's broadcast, many broadcasts. I heard him when I was out on the truck from 1991 into 2001. He wrote a book called The New World Order. He also wrote a book called The Unseen Hand. I met through shortwave, I met a Christian gal. She was married, and I went by and visited her and her husband. And she was legally blind. She had a big machine. and she could blow up the words and she could read. Well, she read that book to me on tape, The Unseen Hand. I had it in my truck. I listened to it 4 or 5 times. And I mentioned this to York before he went on the broadcast. And he said, well, the hidden hand. Who was the hidden hand? That's what, it's called The Unseen Hand. It's a book of about 350 pages of a rabbit hole, running up and down a rabbit hole and up another rabbit hole and around another and never getting to the truth. Always, how's that Bible verse say? Always learning, but never coming to the truth. And so, and you see, another thing that I want to, I should put York on the carpet here. I believe I'm 71 years old. I believe York is, you're 49 or 50, right?
49, yeah.
Now, when I say this, I've already asked this to 3 other men that were younger than me. And when I say this, I was raised and went to high school in Tacoma, Washington, Stadium High School. Now, when I say this, I'm saying this for a reason. See, and I'm not trying to put York down or anybody that I asked this question, but I want you to be honest. You see? Now, also, I was raised in Washington, but this doesn't go for somebody that was raised in Brooklyn. See? Especially Brooklyn and New York City. But Walt's 71 years old, and I'm not trying to elevate myself here, okay? I'm not trying to pull rank because of my age. But Walt went all the way through elementary school, junior high, and high school, and drugs were never offered to me. I went into the military from 62 to 65. I was on a Nike Hercules site. Drugs were never offered, were never on that site. Now beer, yes. But now I can ask the question to you, York, when you were in high school, were you ever offered any drugs?
Well, the equivalent of high school that I went to in Germany, there was one guy in my class who smoked marijuana at that time. And I didn't want to have that experience of smoking weed because at that time I read a book that was called We Children from Station Zoo, which is one of the main underground stations or one of the main train stations in Berlin. Wir Kinder vom Bahnhof Zoo, it's called in Germany. It's written by Christiane F., and she was, when she was 13 years old, out there on the streets selling her body for heroin. And she came into contact with drugs because of a joint in the first place. And I read from that book that this is the entry drug. So I always refused to smoke it. So the first time that I smoked marijuana, that's about some 15 years ago, I think, because one of the good friends that I had when I went to school here in Belgium, I was 29 when I joined a class of students who were all 18 and 19 years old. So I was 10 years older because I came out of the military and studied in the foreign country, Belgium, because I come from Germany. And that one guy that became my best friend at the time, he was hard on weed and he smoked that a lot. And one of these days, then I gave into the idea of smoking pot too, and I smoked a marijuana cigarette. But it stayed that way for many, many years. So normally I can say by the time that I went through the normal school system, and I left the school system in 1983, I actually have never been offered any drugs, no. But that's quite some different picture when you go to school today, I think.
Well, and the other three fellows that I asked, one of them, when I asked him, he was 55, and I asked him the same question, and he looked at me and said, Walt, everybody smoked it. Now, and the point I'm trying to point out is the drug war was introduced. And see, the drug war causes irrationalism. I don't care what kind of drug you're on. I'm drug free. I don't even drink coffee. Now, that don't make me better now. But I had a little heart problem a couple of years ago, and I don't want to cook up any more heart problems. I could cook it up in 2 weeks. But the problem I'm trying to, what I'm trying to say to you is I learned this when I was out in the truck. I learned that there was a behavior problem. I noticed the same behavior. I went through a divorce in 1986. And yet I look back in life now, you know, and this crept in to theology, irrationalism. You see, and we've been, York and I have been accused of being anti-American. Now, let me tell you something. I am very pro-Bible, and I'm not ashamed of being an American. And the thing we're going to start reading tonight, we're going to start talking about the founding of America. It's a division as big as futurism. The futurist almost, this runs in it runs with, futurism runs with the fact that we were Christians, that the founders were Christian. No, you see, that is fiction. See, that is history, fiction. Now, that's not my opinion. But see, we have many, many book salesmen that have wrote books. They cannot read this little book that I put together with many authors in this book. The reason they can't read this book, because it dispels their book. They have an agenda. And where America was strong, and what brought this country down was the pulpit, not the government. If it wasn't for the pulpit, the government couldn't be doing what it's doing, inviting a Jesuit Pope, the little horn of Daniel, the man of sin, the son of perdition in 2 Thessalonians, and the mother of harlots in Revelation 17. It's the pulpit that they went after. The ecumenical movement started in 1776. And when I hear a young man accuse me of being anti-American when he's only in his mid-40s, I'm going to tell you something. The only difference between him and myself, I've made more mistakes. And listen, facts, knowledge is an accumulation of facts, and wisdom is the ability to use them. And when you have all of these booksellers out here you're going to have a visit from the Pope, because the Pope is running the pulpit. Everybody's anti-government, anti-government. It's the pulpit they went after. And this country afforded freedoms that no other countries had. I'll give you an example. The jury system. 12 jurors. Not only that, this is the only country where you were a citizen. Now, how did they override the jury system? We still have a jury system. You try to find 12 juries that can think rational. They've been fed history fiction. That's what's kept us out of the Dark Ages. I had an opportunity the other day to share at a lunch, and I was bold. I came right out and said it. Sodomy was made legal by the Roman Catholic Church. I said, you realize there's 6 out of 9 chief justices are Catholic, and the other three, 2 out of 3 are CFR. So you might as well throw it in. 8 out of 9 are Roman Catholic. And you see, this country has been conquered. It's not if it's been conquered. It's conquered. It's the American people have been fed so much history fiction that they can't tell the difference between fantasy and reality, because it was the pulpit. Every single Bible college and seminary teach futurism. There's no way the Pope could have come over here if it wasn't for the pulpit. And you know, I'd like to give you an example how irrational these book salesmen are. There's a part of me that doesn't want to talk about it, because I don't want to bring up any names. But this irrational behavior almost pushed me over the edge in 1986. Because I go back in my life now and I realize how ignorant I was. And you know, I just read this this morning. You know, this is out of chapter 19, out of All Roads Lead to Rome, by Michael D. Simlin. And also, I don't want to forget this. You can know more about it and where to get it. I think these are two. Now, these people are not book salesmen, okay? It's reformationfaith.com. I think there's a place there to purchase, and I haven't purchased it yet, but I will be purchasing his two books that I know of. This is out of chapter 19, Bible Prophecy of the Antichrist. I read this once, but listen, you've got to let this soak in where we're at today. And the few people that are on this call have been called. Let me explain this. This is a quote from the author. The author recognizes that for all the weight of evidence, all the lessons of history, all the testimony of great men, the reader will not fully recognize the role of Rome nor the roads which lead to her, unless God in his grace quickens the understanding through his word. There's not one of you here today that's come here with your own intellect. You've been given it. It's a blessing. Some of the things that I know and are in this little booklet that I put, this booklet that I'm talking about, The Vatican Jesuit Global Conspiracy, dispels all of these book salesmen. Every single one of them. Because I'll tell you why. The word Jesuit is not in their vocabulary. The word Dark Ages is not in their vocabulary. The Inquisition is not in their vocabulary. And in this book, The Vatican Jesuit Global Conspiracy, I made a mistake last week. I said that this author had the Royal Declaration in his book. He mentioned the Glorious Revolution, but not the Royal Declaration. But listen, if you know about the Royal Declaration, you heard it, you got it off GrandDesignExposed.com, our Hour of the Truth. Now, am I pounding my chest? No. How buried? It's still buried. John Daniel, the author of The Grand Design Exposed, who researched for 25 years before he wrote his book, is how I found it. And it's not in his book because he didn't have it when he wrote the book. He was doing some research and happened to be going through the Glorious Revolution and found the Royal Declaration. But see, this is how they've captured the pulpit. They've taken and given them history fiction. They're telling them about something that never existed. What do you mean by that? The founders of this country were not Christians. It's just a simple lie. It's omission. They're not lying. They just omit it. They don't give us any history. How many people can go into a bar and ask for a Bloody Mary? And everybody in this room probably knows what a Bloody Mary is, tomato juice and some other, you know. But how many people know why it's called a Bloody Mary? Because Mary, the daughter of Henry VIII, when she took reign, she unloaded on the Protestants. She unloaded. And by the act of God, she only lived 5 years. She got cancer and died. But until she did die, she killed over 300 martyrs. She was cleansing England of the Protestants. If you haven't read this history, nobody could write a novel like this. If they told the history, the true history in America, there's no way that the Pope could be coming over here if the pulpit was doing their job. Because after Mary died, we had Elizabeth I, and she was a Protestant. And she lived for 45 years, and they tried to assassinate her over 20 times. And in 1587, Spain and France got together and sailed down to England with 130 ships against England's 60. And because an act of nature of the wind blew them past England. If they'd have been successful, we'd be speaking Spanish, not English. That is history. not history fiction. And the reason why I could never get on Hagman's or any of these, they won't let anybody come on and talk history. It's not allowed. It's in this book. There's enough pieces of the puzzle in this book, The Vatican Jesuit Global Conspiracy. Every time I print one and bind it by hand, I realize what I'm up against. And it's still, you can get this book on the internet today. We need to take advantage of what we've got today. No, forget about what's happening in the future. We've got to do what we can do today. Because if the people understood what was in this book, there would be an uproar. That's what happened with the Glorious Revolution. Because Elizabeth lived to about 1605, and James the First took over. And she lived for 45 years, and she was called the Virgin Queen. She was not a virgin in physical means, as a virgin as we know. But I'll tell you where she was a virgin. She never fornicated with Rome. And what we're seeing here in a couple weeks is fornication because of the pulpit. Don't blame the government. We're blaming the wrong party. And you know, I want to mention one other a name. It's Eric Phelps. Now, I mentioned this a month ago, month and a half ago, and I got some phone calls, a couple phone calls. Now, understand when I mention Eric Phelps, it's not what he is saying. It's what he is leaving out. That's what's missing. What is he leaving out? You can look in his 856-page book, and you're not going to see the carols, and you're not going to get anything. You're not going to get anything about the Royal Declaration. You see, you're not going to get anything about the Spanish Armada and what it was all about. They're not going to put these pieces together. And then they're going to tell you, why does he, again, it's not what he is saying. It's what he is leaving out. So now can you learn something from Eric Phelps? Of course, I did. Man, when Eric Phelps used to be on Greg Samaski's broadcast, I really enjoyed it. As a matter of fact, then I listened to him when he got his own broadcast, and it could only last about a week, and I couldn't. It was like a flip flop when he got his own broadcast. But when he's on somebody else's broadcast, he's kind of tame. But it wasn't until I started doing my own research and realizing what he was omitting. Now, here's another key factor that we got to get in our mind straight. George Washington, according to Eric Phelps, was a Calvinist Baptist. He's even got a picture in his book with John Gaynor, I forget the man that was baptizing him, giving the Catholic Trinity sign over Washington's head. You know, the reason, you know, Washington, and I learned this through Chris Pinto, and York and I have been called Saucyites because we've read and understand what Tupper Saucy was saying. See? And in other words, and I couldn't understand Eric Phelps calling Chris Pinto a Jesuit coadjutor. See? And Tupper Saucy. Wasn't until I realized that he's trying to cover up the founding of America. See, the American Revolution was counter-reformation. Now listen, I'm an American. Don't be saying I'm anti-American. They didn't get everything they wanted. Those Bill of Rights are Protestant, Protestant principles. But when you look at the history of America, by 1850, they were the largest denomination. And then we had the Civil War. That Constitution and Bill of Rights was a thorn in their side from get-go. Then when you read Justin Fulton, Washington in the Lap of Rome in 1888. Justin Fulton is trying to warn the American people of the fifth column that's in America. And then we had the futurism pill dropped on us in about the mid-1800s with the Scofield Bible. And they hit the pulpit. They hit the pulpit. They started a civil war to see how many Protestants they could kill. Rome doesn't care. They don't care. They have a long-term goal. It's very chilling. And it should make us a little bit weary. But man, I listened to my email box this morning. I got some emails from people that should know better. If I spent the next half hour trying to explain what I think is going to happen, let's talk about what's happened and what's going to happen in a couple weeks. It's all, anytime you want to defuse a book salesman, you find out what they're saying about Rome. And there's another catch to this. What do they say about the founding of this country? If they try to wrap themselves up in that flag and eliminate real history instead of history fiction. You see, history tells us that the American Revolution was all about religion. It's not about tea and taxes. You see, they've got to have that. And Eric Phelps is a futurist. Now, it goes back to what I was talking about, the age of irrationalism. Think about it. And blaming, and Chris Pinto. And I'll tell you something. It's in Chris Pinto's broadcast and his video, The Hidden Faith of the Founding Fathers. If you will listen closely, every single one of those founders has a Jesuit link to him. I'm not going to go into it now, but it's there. One whole section of the Hidden Faith of the Founding Fathers is called Washington and the Jesuit Connection. Now, Chris Pinto is a futurist. Yeah, Chris Pinto is a futurist. And you see, they are limited to a certain audience. In other words, if he could never advocate and say, he could never look at the true history, because it was religion that motivated the American Revolution. All the Jesuits wanted was a foot in the door. That's all they wanted. Because the Jesuits know how to do the rest. And for somebody, I mean, some of these book writers, I've even heard them say it, that we're going to take America back. Back to what? We never had it in the first place. And who took us back? The pulpit took us back. The pulpit. And then you're talking to somebody that's been to a seminary or a Bible college. I'm not talking about their salvation. They know part of the gospel, but they don't know the whole gospel. They want to eliminate Daniel. They want to eliminate Paul. They want to eliminate John. They're not. Every single pulpit in America today, you send me, I look on the internet, you show me where somebody has come out of a Bible college or a seminary and has given us the whole gospel. The whole gospel is just what I said. God give us, he showed us who our adversary is. And so when York was reading that article at the beginning of the broadcast, I mean, it just takes you back. There's people, I was sent a link today, just a one-minute ABC link. And man, you can take this. They are going to give open arms to this guy. And can you imagine a man that calls himself God? Who else on the earth calls himself God and wants to be worshipped in a temple? It's right in 2 Thessalonians. And people will fight you to the... I mean, I have been called an idolater because I expose too much and talk about Rome too much. Because, you see, I learned this from reading this Michael DeSindlin. You know, just call the Pope the Antichrist. It's much bigger than that. It's in Daniel, the little horn in Daniel. The man of sin. It's in Revelations, the whole chapter of Revelations. Yeah, there's many Antichrists. Billy Graham's one. I'm not, you can't say this, and Chris Pinto could never say this. His money would dry up, boom, like this. It just instantly. These men, I can't think, Copeland, Kenneth Copeland, Benny Hinn. There are many antichrists. And every time I hear somebody talking about the antichrist to come out in the future, you know, it just takes me back. I get a little bit weary And I've used this time that York has allowed me to just try to get some stuff off my heart. And I got a few, I've been blessed. I got a few people that I can call and I can visit. But because there's some people, depending where you're at, you're all by yourself. And you know, these people go on the attack. And you know, I want to recap the word casuistry and sophistry real quick. Casuistry is dishonest reasoning. Sophistry is the art of influencing the thought and conduct of an audience by argumentation. Dishonest reasoning and the art of influencing thought and conduct. It's the reason I asked York about drugs. Because one thing I didn't cover, I was divorced 3 times, but my mother and father weren't divorced. I had aunts and uncles that divorce wasn't even in my vocabulary. I didn't see it. But when they hit us with this irrational behavior and this postmodern thinking, you see, divorce rate went out of sight. It went out of sight. So when I'm dealing with some of these younger men and, you know, that come from broken homes, and I mean, they've never had any stability. And listen, my foundation was rocked in 1986. And only by the grace of God did I have the mechanics of what really went on. It was much bigger than my wife and I. I mean, you go down a rabbit hole and start blaming Joe Blow. Because what they do, Jesuit casuistry and sophistry, they have, and look what they did with theology. They got people believing in the rapture. It's not in the Bible. And they're going to, you know how they're going to, expound this to you? They're going to use dishonest reasoning, and they're going to use the art of influencing the thought and conduct of an audience by argumentation. Okay. Well, anyway, excuse me for the interruption, but this casuistry and sophistry, when I first come across it, and anybody that, you know, I think we all have a hard time piecing this together, but this has been used so much. And how'd they do it? They changed the TV became the pulpit. The TV became the pulpit. In other words, what they have, you know, see, fantasy is being taught as reality. And it goes right back to these book salesmen. They're talking about history that is fantasy. And they want to teach you to you as reality. Of course, the two are not going to mix. You're going to have to drop your guard. You're going to have to drop your guard and go down the rabbit hole with them. See, I've had some things played on me, and I'll tell you the ones that are the best at it are these ministers. When you go in and you start talking to one of these ministers, you're there to ask questions. You're there to listen, not to ask questions. And these men, they have it down to a science. Soon as they find a little disagreement, they know how to touch you. They know how to set you off. Oh, I've had it done so many times in my life. I mean, this, and what is it? It's like water runs downhill. It's false doctrine. They've taken the simplicity out of the gospel. And they try to make it like they have a corner on it. And when you disagree with them, man, they paste you. So, you know, my message today is to see through these book salesmen. And to understand a book salesman, you've got to know some history. And some of the history that I've covered this morning, when you get into it, it reads better than any novel you could ever buy. The real truth. So anyway, this is chapter 31. We're going to cover chapter 31 in code word Barbalon, danger in the Vatican. And it's chapter 31. And I think when we read this and understand that P.D. Stewart would be considered a Jesuit coadjutor. It's real important to understand when you find somebody eliminating and not talking about something, it's a lie. They're lying to you. You don't think that Eric Phelps knows all about Charles, Daniel, and John? Can we really come to the conclusion that he just doesn't know? Listen, he's a walking encyclopedia, okay? The man has forgot more history than I know. But what is he doing? What is he doing? He is leaving out the meat of history. He's leaving it out. So when you're out and about in these YouTubes and looking at some of this, when somebody gives you a presentation of 3 hours and doesn't mention the Jesuits, oh, the latest thing with Alex Jones is he's having a, what do you call it, a collection. He wants to get $1 million so he can access 10 million viewers. People need to get back to their Bible. And how much history do you get from Alex Jones? Now, listen, you can learn things from Alex Jones. I've listened to Alex Jones. I'm not saying, but you have to, if you cannot decipher these book salesmen. Because, see, there's, now, give you an example. If you go back in the archives and some of the books that Tom Fresh has read on Inquisition Update, these are not book salesmen. Justin Fulton, you know, John W. Robbins, these people know our historists. there is a, but when people, you know you're going to get derailed when somebody comes upon the founders and wants to make them Christian. Even to this day, I get inside of me, and I can't people see this? Why can't people see this? And I give you the answer. See, you know, all the lessons of history, all the testimony of great men, the reader will not fully recognize the role of Rome, nor the roads which lead to her, unless God in his grace quickens the understanding through his word. You didn't learn this through your intellect. If you think you're talking to the brightest bulb in Bandon, you're mistaken. But I do know one thing. I do know who Bloody Mary is and why it's named Bloody Mary. I do know who the Royal Declaration. I do know these key points in history that was revealed to us. If you've heard of the Royal Declaration for the first time, it's not because Walt or York. It's because it's been revealed to you. Your eyes have been opened, and you have ears to hear and eyes to see. All we have to do is open and ask. Ask. That's why we know. That's why anymore, you see, it's going to be hard for somebody to suck me into an argument. Well, they try. They try. But when you know the truth doesn't need to be debated. It doesn't need a book written about it to explain you the history fiction. Man, I'm telling you, when I wake up sometimes, it still makes me a little weary. How ignorant, how empty they've kept my head for 71 years. So anyway, with that, York, I appreciate your patience for listening to me, but I had a lot on my heart this morning because this is a very touchy, true to my heart, this chapter that we're going to read on page 92 in the Vatican Jesuit Global Conspiracy. So I thank you for listening.
You're welcome, Walt. It was very interesting to listen to you, and I have to say a little something about this, what you said about being an American hater or American basher. The thing that people do not get when we reveal the true history and the true people who were behind the founding of the nation state of the United States of America and how they did it. We are doing the historical work to tell the people how the nation really has been founded. How can you call that hating America? If we didn't love the country, if we didn't love the people over there, I mean, over there, from my point of view, here in Belgium, why would I even bother doing that? I would really, if I would hate Americans, I would love to see them suffer, right? I would love to see them continue in their false ways, instead of telling them that all that they have been taught concerning history of their own country is a lie. Because we are living in a world of lies today. Why would I do any effort to tell the people about the real history of their country if I hated them? Just think of that. And the same goes for Walt. And it is never the people. It's the same with Catholics. I love the people, but I despise their hierarchy and their belief system they are caught in ignorantly. That has nothing to do with hate. That has nothing to do with being an American or Catholic basher. That has to do with the intention from the people here on this call to open the eyes of the people to see the real truth and to come to their senses and come back to the Word. The Word being the King James Bible, which is the only truth that we have in this world. And I would never do that if I hated America or the American people. So I hope you see that this is just stupid to call us American bashers or American haters when all we do is tell them about the real history of their country so that they can understand why America is going that way that it is going now or that it has been going for the last 100 years. Because it all started in the beginning of the 20th century, or even in the midst of the 19th century, as Walt said, with this futurist deception that came up, with the founding of Zionism, and all that stuff. And if you do not know your real history, then you will never understand where you are standing now. So we are just trying to help to understand that. And if you think that we are lying through our teeth, well then write us and tell us where we are wrong. But you have to base that on facts. And that's the problem. You can't. Because the facts we give to you, we don't suck them out of our thumb and throw them out here on the broadcast or on any video. But we studied these books, read these books, or at least parts of these books. I mean, I went through watching the whole Total Onslaught series with Walter Veit. I'm still not done yet. And watching videos of Bob Treffs from 1994, the military takeover of America. I had to stop that video every few minutes because he cited from another book, and I went to the internet and downloaded that book as a PDF. I downloaded 7 volumes of the history of the Inquisition. Each volume between 600 and 700 pages. Of course, I didn't read it all. That would be impossible in the short time. But I include that into my knowledge and open these books and read here a little and read there a little. And I see everything that is written in the Bible confirmed through history. And this is what we are doing here. So, but now I will take the last 15 minutes that we have on the broadcast left to start reading on page 92 on the PDF on the Vatican Jesuit conspiracy, a global conspiracy from Walt Sickle that he put together. From page 92, Code Word Babylon, Danger in the Vatican by P.D. Stewart in his book Chapter 31, The Revolutionary War, How America Became a Jesuit Enclave. And it starts with a quote from former U.S. President John Adams in 1816, which is very interesting. You will see in a moment, because it is from 1816, what happened, remember, in 1814. Quote, "A most colossal conspiracy against the United States. I do not like the resurrection of the Jesuits," unquote, because the Jesuits were resurrected by a papal bull 2 years earlier in 1814. We now come to another highly interesting portion of American history, which you would be hard-pressed to find in the history books. The part played by the Jesuits in the American Revolutionary War, the War of Independence between 1776 and 1783. We have seen the role of the Jesuits in the American Civil War, but what part, if any, did they play in the earlier war that transformed America from a collection of independent states to a United States of America? The uninformed or partisan historians will tell us that this war was mainly, if not entirely, due to the arbitrary and intolerable acts of the British government leading to the American colonists' desire to break with British rule. I will now venture to shed some light on this dimly reported aspect of American history and offer you a very different and, hope, more correct view. That religion played a major role in the American Revolution is beyond dispute. In 1776, at the time of the Declaration of Independence, there were little over 23 priests in all. and the next highest authority was the Vicar Apostolic in London, who had jurisdiction over the British colonies and satellites in America. The American Revolutionary War of Independence soon changed that. The reason there were so few Catholics and so many more Protestants was because of the foundation of the great democracy that is today called the United States of America was laid when millions of European Protestants fled the oppression of the Roman Catholic Church in Europe to seek freedom of conscience and religion in the most uninhabited wilderness of North America. Before the settlers were solved not to duplicate in the New World what they had fled from on the Old Continent. These settlers felt that the Pope, a foreign ruler, should not be allowed to meddle in the politics or laws of America, as they suspected that would render it difficult for immigrants, especially Catholics, to be fully loyal to the new country and to its fledging Republican values.
Comment?
Yeah, please.
Just a, in other words, and all I want to do is make one comment. All we have to do now is look in 2015 and in other words, you know, who benefited from the American Revolution? That's all you got to ask. Who benefited? And history tells us in 2015 who's the benefactor. You know, that's why all of these fiction or history fiction books, when they do not put in religion, the American Revolution was to break the British colonies, the Protestant colonies, from England.
From Protestant England.
Yes. From Protestant England, and you know.
And allow the Roman Catholic Church in the New World, which was forbidden in England at that time.
You know, I can't tell you what button it is now, but if you really want to know the difference between the Declaration of Indulgence in 1688 and the Declaration of Independence in 1776, go to granddesignexposed.com and go down to the button. I can't tell you what number button it is, but it's called Untold History. This is a must listen if you haven't listened to it. And on December 8, 2008, Tom Fress interviewed Chris Pinto. And he gives you a perfect example, the comparison. When you understand the two and how they, and then read chapter 16, and I do have that up on the internet too, chapter 16 of Rulers of Evil. I mean, you'll see what happened with the Declaration of Independence. You know, see all the, in other words, it wasn't, listen, people want to say, well, they want to tell you that it wasn't all Catholic. No, it wasn't. But the Masons, Freemasonry is Catholicism. They had already infiltrated Freemasonry, and I just listened to a news clip about the present Pope, and you know, the Masons, the Grand Master of Argentina, congratulated the Pope when he became the Pope. I mean, the Masons and the Pope, they've always tried to make it out that there's a schism between the two. There's no schism between the two. They're both universalist. When we got a universal government, you know, we didn't get a Protestant government. There's nothing in the Constitution of the United States that's Protestant. That's saying anything against any. It's freedom. It's a universal document. And when you understand history and what Rome is guilty of, you see you see what's happened to America. Because again, I am not against America. There's a reason why America prospered, and Mexico is so poor in South America. There's a reason for it. This is the last bastion of a Protestantism, which has been nullified by the pulpit. It no longer exists. Now, it's a hard apple for me. And am I trying to gain followers? I mean, what am I going to do? Just kind of act like I don't know about it? But people, I mean, once you know the truth, once you understand it, you've got to tell the people. I mean, this country's produced an awful lot. We don't produce anything anymore. We don't produce any. They've taken our production totally out of this country.
Yeah, you don't even produce those shovels anymore to dig your own grave.
No. And the only thing we make is a lot of guns. You know, I mean, the car was manufactured here at the beginning. You know, it was here in the United States. Now we don't. I think GMC, but this is something that the people don't want to accept. You know, because they've been given science fiction all their life. You know, they're listening. They've been in. They started us with, you know, they keep us occupied in another direction. You know. Anyway, that's all I got to say.
Okay. I will continue for a few moments on reading on page 93. Naturally, there was a fear of Roman Catholics, not unlike the fear many Americans today have of Muslim fundamentalists. After all, these early Protestant pilgrims had recently escaped the hands of their Catholic compatriots. In those days, people took their Catholicism really seriously. So much so that several states passed laws regulating the activities of Roman Catholics. For example, in 1647, the Massachusetts statutes declared that every priest was an, quote, incendiary and disturber of the public peace and safety, and an enemy of true Christian religion, unquote. The early American settlers suspected that the Pope was seeking to meddle in the affairs of the United States, to undermine its republican values, which they said was evidenced by the oath that every Catholic bishop was required to take. Quote, I will, to the utmost of my power, see out and oppose schismatics, heretics, and the enemies of our sovereign Lord, the Pope, and his successors, unquote. However, the period following the restoration of the Jesuits in 1814 saw a tremendous growth in their numbers and influence in America, as evidenced by the large number of Jesuit colleges and universities established on that continent in that century. 22 of the society's 28 universities. In those days, says historian René Fulop Miller, one of Benjamin Franklin's friends was a Jesuit. This was John Carroll, who had been brought up in Maryland of Irish parentage. He would later become the Archbishop of Baltimore and go on to establish the Jesuit University of Georgetown in a, quote, a suburb of the city of Washington, the federal capital, the first Catholic educational institution in the United States. According to Robert Emmett Curran, in his Bicentennial History of Georgetown University, the Society of Jesus resolved in 1786 to found Georgetown to supply for Catholics in the new republic the clergy from whom the society had provided previously. John Carroll was born in 1735 at Upper Marlborough, Maryland. After receiving a Jesuit education at Bohemia in Cecil County, Maryland, Carroll studied abroad at Jesuit colleges in Europe. He was forced to flee Europe when the Jesuits were expelled from Sweden under the decree of Pope Clement in 1773. And on August 15, 1790, Reverend John Carroll was appointed the first Catholic bishop in the United States of America, being consecrated on the Feast of the Assumption. At the time, the papacy not only had to deal with concerns of Americans that these revolutionary Jesuit outcasts were migrating to America, it also had to quell the fears of the American people that the Catholic Church in America was itself no more than a Trojan horse for the installation of a foreign ruler, the Pope. To overcome these suspicions, the Jesuit John Carroll advised the Pope to have the portion of the oath which required allegiance to the Pope above all others removed from the American bishop's pledge. This was done to avoid giving offense to the principles of the Constitution and to calm fears that the Catholic bishops were merely puppets of the Pope on American soil. Now, before we go into the next part of this chapter, we will stop the broadcast for today because it's been an hour and a half. We will continue next week on the Intolerable Acts. But I only have to say one thing of the thing that I've just read. Please go to my YouTube channel and check out the playlist, The Global Vatican, where Tom Fress reads the book The Global Vatican, written by Francis Rooney, the American ambassador to the Vatican between 2005 and 2008. He will go deeply into the story of the Carrolls, that they were nothing else than mercenaries who gained all their wealth by fighting wars for the Pope in Rome. And you will get much more behind the idea of the Trojan horse that I just mentioned here, which was, in my opinion, the biggest Trojan horse was the religious freedom that was granted with the founding of America with the Constitution. Let me just ask you one question. Is there freedom of religion in the kingdom of God? Was there freedom of religion in the Israel of the Old Testament? Check it out, read it for yourself, study it for yourselves, if there was any. So, Walt, do you have any closing remarks shortly?
No. No, I appreciate people listening to me. I have to admit that when you absorb some of this, and God only gives you a little bit that you can stand at a time, you know. But you know, I like I said, I appreciate the people that have listened and sent me emails, and you know, and an encouragement, because sometimes it you get a little weary when you realize, you know, I feel like David and Goliath, you know, going out there with my slingshot and printing a book on my on my computer. Yeah,
I can tell you, Walt, it's the same here. And the more I get attacked, the more I know that I am in the truth.
Yes.
If everybody is just caressing your shoulder and tapping your shoulder and says you're doing a good work and all this, well, pull out your guns and be very, very careful of that flattery. But when you get criticism like that, when you know that you stand on the truth, because you know you stand on the rock, on the foundation of the Bible of 1611 and on the word of Jesus Christ, then they can criticize me as much as they want. And every criticism is only a confirmation that I am right. So, I'm going to end the call here. Thank you very much, Walt, for your lengthy contribution to this broadcast today. It was very much appreciated. And next week, I hope we will get a little bit more time to read in this wonderful part of the book of your Jesuit Vatican Global Conspiracy, The Code Word Babylon Danger and the Vatican, Chapter 1 by P.D. Stewart. And anyone who wants to do his own research, well, just go down or go to the internet and download that book. I guess you can get it as a PDF. I will check that later, but I guess it is so. And probably I will put it into my library too. So thank you everybody who was here in the chat room to listen to the live broadcast. And thank you everybody else for watching the video I will make from this broadcast. And I hope to see you next week again. Until then, God bless you and bye-bye.
Call recording has been completed.
Yeah. I thought that you had some email things that you wanted to discuss, Walt. You didn't go into that.
Noel, I didn't get into that. I didn't get into that.
I was all the time waiting for that. So you will do that next week then, or what?
Well, I might, you know, but you know, I finally see the mechanism, York. I see the mechanism when somebody, in other words, I can disagree with you. I can disagree with you, but when somebody attacks you, you know, like this, like old Johnny, you know,
Johnny Turucci.
In other words, when I told him, when he made all these things, all these comments, you know, and all I did is send him a link, and then when I wrote him back and told him, I told him I'm just another jerk. Please take me off. Take me off your mailing list. You know, he considers himself an author. See, that's the caliber of authors we have, and people like Eric Phelps, how he's elevated, you know, and he's not telling you the truth. See, you know,
he's only telling so much of the truth, you know.
Well, and he's trying. The problem
is Eric John Phelps teaches to people who have no idea of the real history. So everything that he says, they suck up like a dry sponge.
They don't question.
They don't question if there is any more or not. And that's the problem. Lot of people only rely on one or two sources for the study they do. They don't look very much left and right. They are still in the same paradigm as they were told in schools, because that's the way we were brought up, you know? Never question anything. And when you have never heard of the carols, how can you ever get there? So you have to read more books than only Vatican Assessments, which by the way is concerning the research. A great book. But leaves out so many things.
And well, he doesn't connect the dots.
No, that's the thing. Yeah, you know, he has a jigsaw puzzle and he has pieces, but when you put it together and you know how the jigsaw should look like, you see that there are missing pieces, and those are the missing pieces of, first of all, of course, his false teaching of George Washington was a Baptist, and of course, it's not mentioning of the Carroll family and all its implications. And this is where the big difference is between Eric John Phelps and Tupper Saucy. And I found it very interesting that on the internet, when I was researching, I went to Tupper Saucy's page, and I found an email exchange between Tupper Saucy and Eric John Phelps. That may be some interesting part to do once in our show here. Where Eric John Phelps made allegations against Tupper Saucy, and Tupper Saucy said, okay, now will you please give me the reasons for the assumptions that you make and make the points that I can disprove you. And he never went into that.
No.
He never went into that in the email exchange.
Listen, you know, what has got on my heart is Eric Phelps and these men – They're preaching another gospel.
Yeah, of course. And like you said, they're futurists. Yeah.
Yes.
Even though that Eric John Phelps absolutely knows who the Antichrist is.
Yeah.
And he knows that the Pope of Rome is the Antichrist. He still teaches futurism. Now you can say, but how is that possible? How is that possible? Because he teaches a 7-year tribulation and a rapture.
And this
is only because he twists the word of God in the book of Daniel, chapter 9, verse 24 to 27, especially verse 27, where there is no other but Christ mentioned, not the Antichrist. And that is exactly what Eric John Phelps does, and what all these so-called, as you call them, book salesmen do. It's all the same.
Yes.
They all have the same agenda. Nobody really goes to the ground. You know, this is why I love so much the last but one upload I did on my YouTube channel. You probably saw that in the meantime. There was an excerpt from Tom Press reading part 33 of Global Vatican. I called the video The Truth Behind the Nation State of Israel. Nobody that I know, except for you and except for Tom, nobody in the world teaches that. Nobody touches that piece of dirt over there in Palestine they call today Israel, and why it is there and why it has to be funded. And what is the reason of that? Nobody touches that.
Well, they have to have it for their future.
There's one more, sorry. Prophecy, reality, Nicholas Arthur, cross the border, the rock. He also is aware of that. But for the rest, you will not find anybody who addresses that subject.
Well, I know it. In other words, that's when you get a little bit weary, because you know you're right.
Yeah, you know, there's a saying that comes from, what's this guy's name? Paul Claudel. He was a French author, lived between 1868 and 1955. And he made a quote, "Truth has nothing to do with the number of people who are convinced of it." And that's the problem. People always think the majority is right.
The majority is
always wrong. That's the problem. And it takes a lot to stand alone. It takes nothing to join the crowd, but it takes everything to stand alone. And you can only do that when you have the real foundation of the truth behind you, which is the Word of God and nothing else. Point. And there's no discussion about that.
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. I was in the other room and I was just wondering if I was Mike. But no. That's why the more you understand this, and like you said, see, they got to have the dispensational to have their future, see. They can't. The both of them are work together. You know, they got to have both. You know. Yeah, because everything that's going on over in Israel right now is not of God. You know. I mean, that's it's. and you know something. I'm getting a little bit weary. The word is weary because we've got so much. The pieces are fit so. They fit so much now and. And then when I hear what the Pope's coming over here and how people people are going to greet him in open arms, you know, and it's when I was having dinner or lunch with those people down the way where I'm working, I realized just how ignorant. They've got the general masses and how ignorant I've been. And I have to remind myself, like this morning, I had to remind myself of how this author said this. See, the reader will not fully recognize the role of Rome nor the roads which lead to her unless God in his grace quickens the understanding through his word. In other words, there's no way you can see Israel if you look at God's word, I mean, there's no way you can't see the futurist if you're looking at Daniel, you know, Christ's whole ministry on earth was a fulfillment of Daniel, you know, mm-hmm. of the 70th week, and they're denying it. they're denying it.
Yeah, they actually deny Jesus Christ.
Yes, they're actually denying.
That's
it.
That's what it all comes down to.
Yes, it does.
The whole world is prepared to accept another Christ, as Jesus Christ warned us. He warned the Jews. I have come in my Father's name, and you did not receive me. And someone else will come in his own name, and him you will receive. That's what Jesus warned us about, and this is exactly what's playing. And it's not only playing for the Jews; it's playing for all the world. And the people do not see that, and the people do not know that. Why? Because they do not read the Bible anymore. Or when they read a Bible, they don't take the right Bible. It's a shame, but that's why they are so deceived. I mean, wasn't it J. Edgar Hoover who said that the conspiracy is so big and so vast that the human mind cannot even comprehend it? And in a way, he was right. he didn't give the solution to see it through the deception, which is reading and understanding the Word of God. Are you still there?
Yes, I'm here.
Oh, it all comes back down to this. You said that also in the broadcast. The simplicity of the gospel. The Bible is easy, folks. The gospel is easy. The problem is that today's teaching, starting with the seminaries and all that stuff, they make it so complicated, and they add a little here, and they add a little there, and they take a little bit away from there, and then they add something else, and then you cannot see through it, and you cannot understand it. They make it so difficult that you do not even want to start. Well, when you have the right source, it is so easy to understand. And something else that I want to say, it is not only easy to understand, it gives you so much rest. It gives you so much peace, Jerome.
Yeah.
I don't care what will happen outside of my four walls anymore, because I know that there is something better waiting for me when I'm gone here. You know, today I was thinking about maybe starting the broadcast a little bit on the discussion of the fugitives that we receive here in Europe over right now. I only see that in Germany. You know, they constantly change the television program on the two state channels we have. We have government television, the first and the second German program, and people are even forced to pay $30 a month. Whether they have it, whether they see it or not, they have to pay that. And this,
can you hear me now?
And this television starts interrupt its normal program all few hours with a special broadcast on the fugitives, and what can we do? And oh, Germany can't handle it. Oh, we call for Europe. Europe has to do it, you know? This is so crazy what's going on. And it's a little bit the same like you have over there in the United States of America with all the fugitives coming over from Mexico. Or the Catholic invasion that you have over there in the United States. And we have the same here in Europe, but our fugitives come from Syria, come from Pakistan, come from Afghanistan, come from Yemen, come from Africa, and they all want to go in three places they want to go. First of all, Germany, second of all, Denmark, and third of all, England. But first of all, Germany. Do you know that this year, the German government estimates that we will have about 800,000 refugees alone in Germany? 800,000! Now, the winter is coming up. We are in September already right now. What the hell are we going to do with 800,000 people who are living out in tents and caravans and all that stuff, in trailers, which have to be heated, and these people come with children, and they have to be fed and everything else? 800,000, that's 1% of the total population of Germany. And this is only this year, and that's an estimate that can be broken, you know. And what will happen next year with this Jubilee year? This is so interesting what's all going to happen. And it's all because we are living in the kingdom of the Antichrist, and people do not see it because they all.
Well, I find it real interesting, you know, York, that they're doing the same thing in Europe. See, in other words, what they're doing is
but on a much bigger scale than they do in America, I can tell you. Because if 800,000 refugees only come to Germany, I think there will be more than 1.5 million coming to Europe all alone.
Yeah, and see, what they're doing is they're weakening you as a nation.
Yeah, of course, and it is meant to be that. And most of these people, of course, who are coming are what? Islam. Muslims.
Mm-hmm.
So on the one hand, they teach this Muslim terrorist threat, and on the other hand, they invite all the Muslims over to our country.
Well, see, they're creating. See,
yeah,
they're,
of course. It's the perfect Hegelian dialectic again. You know?
Yes, absolutely. See, that's where we That's where we get a little weary, and we have to ask God for some strength, because God has revealed some stuff to us this stuff that's been revealed to both of us is not because of our intellect.
No. I would never be as smart as that.
Yeah. I mean, because now you can see the big picture, and when you realize that all these armies, all the military, all over the world are controlled by the Jesuits, you know, and I think the control is coming out of some say it's coming out of NATO, but I still think it's coming out of the Pentagon. You know, I think the Pentagon is still calling the shots, you know.
Sure. And who runs the Pentagon?
The Jesuits. Yeah.
Hola.
Yeah,
so it's
yeah.
All wrong.
Well, listen. I appreciate you. You know, I took more time, but I tell you, it's kind of heavy on my heart. You know, I was going to bring up the email into it, but I didn't do it. But I still, in other words, I wanted to teach the mechanics, see how they work. Like Johnny Cerici, see, he's working. He wants to agitate. They infiltrate, educate, and agitate. I mean, in other words, I'm not saying that he's a Jesuit, but I am saying this, that he's got a behavior problem.
Of course, it's the same like Eric von Phelps and those guys are labor, right?
Yes, they live about 20 minutes apart. They know each other, you know. But Johnny, he's a young man that's got with a little information, and you know did I send that to you? He calls the King James Bible Shakespearean gibberish. You know, did I send you that email?
No, but you told me about it, I think, but you didn't send it to me. Anyway,
no.
I don't care what he thinks, you know. The only thing that we can do is to pray for those people that their eyes will be opened.
Yes.
Because the question that you have to ask yourself with people like Johnny Tarucci is, are these people desperately doing that, or are they just deceived?
Well, I think you're trying
to make... For in case they are deceived, I really pray for them.
Well, I think they're trying to make a living. I think
tries to make a living. I sell alcohol for a living, you know.
But you're not selling. You're not selling books that are, you know. In other words, see, his book is incomplete. Eric Phelps's book is incomplete.
Yeah, sure.
See, it's incomplete. You know, I mean, it's. Say, well, listen, I got to go because I got to go to work. But anyway, thanks. I didn't mean to talk so much, but I appreciate you. You know, allowing me to share my heart.
Well, it's all right. I listened to everything that you said, and I felt that it was something that I had to give that you had to get off your heart.
I'm realizing this little book that I put together is this dispels all the book salesmen. You know, Tex Mars could not allow. He could not read this book. See. You know, because it dispels all his books. See, his books are there's information, but they're incomplete.
Mm-hmm.
See, they're not. I've got to put my I'm connect this.
Answer on.
I'm in business. Well, listen. I love you, brother.
I love you too, Walt, and thanks for the broadcast. It was quite good.
Yeah, next week we might even just recap that a little bit, and we'll continue from there, and call this one the age of the book salesman or something.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
You know something? I get so weary. Like I realized I was talking to Blue Raven, see,
yeah.
And Blue Raven was talking to, he was asking me questions, what I knew about Ralph Epperson, you know, And see, Ralph Everson told him in so many words, the reason why he doesn't talk about the Jesuits is he wants to appeal to a broader, he wants to appeal to a broader audience, see?
Yeah.
See, in other words, I mean, he was...
In other words, I want to make money. I don't want to tell the truth. I want to make money.
Yes, I want to make money, see? I mean, that's basically what he was saying.
What does the Bible say about that, Walt? Buy the truth and sell it not.
Sell it not. Buy the truth. I mean, when you realize, and see, what I'm a little bit overwhelmed with is, you know, I bought every single book that Tex Mars had wrote up until Circle of Intrigue. That's years ago now. But when I was listening to Tex Mars out there, I was so ignorant and I was gobbling up, you know, I was reading his books. But I see that these books are incomplete. They're not complete, and that's in other words, they take you in a circle, and they take you nowhere. See, and you know, and it's but I think I was right. See, they took the pulpit first. They to get a hold of the government, they had to get control of the pulpit. You know. Yeah. So we'll say okay. I'm going to get off here, buddy.
That's all right, Walt. Okay.
And God bless, and we'll get together here this next week and have a little fellowship too. So
okay, you sure will.
Okay, keep on keeping on.
You too, Walt. Bye bye.
Bye for now.